the complications as a result of the tonsillitis. Incidence of these complications is not very high, but you may see that, and in children particularly, this is very important. One of the important cautious issue is if there is a unilateral tonsillitis. If only one side of the tonsil is involved, you have a certain potential risk. Most of the times, incidence-wise, you may not see many patients, but particularly in children, children below 5 years, unilateral tonsillitis often can result in significant complication of a tonsillar abscess later, or it can, so it's better to be cautious, more cautious. I don't say that that's incurable, but it can result in some acute complications and it may go out of hand. So, decision to whether you continue with our treatment or whether you prefer an other antibiotic treatment or have a opinion of the surgeons, that depends upon the patient's condition. And unilateral tonsillitis is always a red sign, red light-like conditions. So, you have to be cautious about. Whereas, bilateral tonsillitis comparatively are safer. And one of the other conditions which can result in severe complications is that the peritonsillar abscess. Peritonsillar abscess, the clinical signs, particularly in children, when the child would have a rigidity of the neck, when the neck is rigid and the swelling is seen on the exterior, that's swelling is seen in the exterior, that's also a critical sign where the patient may have a complication. And that's exactly what Sushruta has described as the balasa. Balasa is one of the asadhya condition where exactly same, very interesting is the description of the balasa and peritonsillar abscess are exactly the same. Virtually, it's only the language is different, Sanskrit language, which describes the same as such. And that's one of the signs. Of course, patients may also have obvious rheumatic signs occasionally, but incidence is rare. And the rheumatic signs are more common in upper class patients. Lower class patients may not have rheumatic signs. If the patient is of upper class, where upper class in the sense usually treated more energetically, having repeated treatment of antibiotics and so on, so-called the over-protected child, issue of rheumatic complications are more. Whereas that incidence of the rheumatic complications is significantly lower in the lower class people. Particularly, I have never seen a patient of rheumatic complication in that Bijapuri working group conditions, though number of patients from that category with the tonsillitis are more. You have more patients, that's very interesting issue, issue which is good enough for an objective study, reasons, etc. But in my observation, such people, they may have more of tonsillitis, but they do not really go into rheumatic complications frequently. Whereas the upper class, more sophisticated people, they may have lesser incidence of tonsillitis comparatively, but complications of rheumatism are more. So, you have to be cautious about the rheumatic sign. Tachycardia is one of the danger signs. Once the patient has a significant tachycardia, you have to be cautious, and then acute rheumatism, definitely, it may not be possible to manage in with our medicines during that acute phase. But once the acute phase is over, then definitely it's an Ayurvedic treatment, Ayurvedic subject. Like a chronic rheumatism is an Ayurvedic subject, but acute rheumatism, it's always preferable to have a course of antibiotic. Right, next. Certain of the confusing conditions with the tonsillitis. Incidents are not many, but herpes is comparatively common. You may at least see some 3% of the total. If you see 100 tonsillitis conditions, at least 3 would be herpetiform. Herpetiform tonsillitis, of course, not significantly different from others, but only the difference is as you have the herpes elsewhere, there could be small eruptions across the oral cavity. It's not limited only to the tonsillar area. It could be seen in the oral mucosa also. But patients may complain of only the pain in the throat. So complaints could be similar. Febrile conditions would be there. And treatment, if you identify that as herpetiform conditions, comparatively the treatment also easier. My treatment there in that condition would be Kamaduga and Paripatidikata. Incidence is not very high, comparatively lesser, but still it may occur. So you have to be alert about that. Every patient presenting with the pain and swelling in the throat is not tonsillitis. That's all the point. So from that point of view, you have to be bothered about. Candidiasis also is another of the condition, but candidiasis also is common in immunocompromised patients, patients with diabetes, particularly diabetic patients. If they have throat pain, you have to be more cautious. It could be candidiasis, and candidiasis would be presenting with that thick exudates, yellowish exudates, and rather condition would be more chronic, usually resistant to the treatment. And when there is an underlying pathology, that underlying pathology needs to be treated. And most of the times there will be an underlying pathology. I have identified diabetes patients first time. Diabetes is identified when the patient had oral candidiasis. So oral candidiasis can be the initial flag sign of diabetes occasionally. So patients might not be knowing about the diabetes, but if they have oral candidiasis and then you investigate, patient may be proved to be diabetes. And hence the priority there would be to manage that underlying condition. If the patient is diabetic, that has to be. HIV, of course, is one of the other condition. Many times leukemias, undiagnosed leukemia, had an incidence of undiagnosed leukemia, where other clinical symptoms were comparatively misleading, but the leukemia was suspected because of candidiasis, and when we progressed along with the investigation lines, leukemia was confirmed. So when you have a oral candidiasis, it's not a simple, straightforward case. Comparatively, incidence is lesser, but you need to have a detailed workout about the underlying cause. And if the underlying cause is identified, then the whole treatment would be according to that underlying pathology. And then, of course, if it's along with that underlying management of the underlying pathology, I would prefer Gandhaka Rasayana and Khadira Arista to be used in case of the candidiasis as such. And the Trifala gargling also would help. And of course, one of the important categories, patients undergoing chemotherapy and or radiation. Candidiasis is quite common complication in patients undergoing chemotherapy or radiation. And use of any other antibiotic or antifungal drugs often can result in more complications. And in that condition, Trifala quatha gargling alone would be quite significantly useful. Patients undergoing chemotherapy, one of our strong area which we can recommend. We may not intervene with the chemotherapy, need not give any internal medicine. Trifala quatha gargling alone can help in significant resolution of the symptom. Of course, carcinoma, transcellular carcinoma is a rare phenomenon, but still occasionally it may occur. So only the thing is, you should be alert. So every swollen tonsil is not a tonsillitis. That's all the point. Next. Now, that's about the tonsils. When you descend down from the tonsils, the next area where you usually have the clinical presentation is the tracheitis. Identification of the tracheitis is by a dry cough and the hoarseness of the voice. Characteristic hoarseness of the voice is a typical feature, and usually fever will be low degree as such. And exact description is swaraha described by Vaghbhata. Vaghbhata has described that swaraha as the disease where you will have the hatha swaraha, that difficult feature is described. All that point is, every such conditions, every such variable clinical conditions are described in the text, and there is a specific line of management. We might not be really following it. That's all the point. And again, as far as the treatment is concerned, there is not much of a very significant issue unless the condition is persisting for a long period. My guideline is, if the patient has that hoarseness of the voice persisting for a more than 3 weeks, then laryngoscopy is a must. I do that laryngoscopy if it is persisting beyond 3 weeks. Up to 3 weeks we can. Of course, this is not a universal guideline. This is a guideline which I have framed for my practice alone. By that you can be safe. Otherwise, misleading conditions, many critical conditions like tumors, tuberculosis, can also present with the same symptoms occasionally, and hence a laryngoscopy is a safer investigation. But usually I prefer it only after 3 weeks. And the majority of the conditions you can manage. Incidence of such issues also are not very common, but even one patient among hundreds also is significant enough. So safe issue is to be considered as such. So chronic conditions, when the patient has a history for long duration, it's better to be safeguarded. Right, next part. Now, the next, of course, is the tracheitis, where you will have further deeper down into the area. And in that condition, the patient would have a typically pain in the chest. Substernal pain is the characteristic feature of the tracheitis. sputum also is comparatively lesser. And this is exactly again described by Bhagbhata as well as Charaka as a Vataja or Pittaja complications. When it is a Vataja complication, characteristically the feature is a dry sputum, antakkapham iranena kasayata, and Swarabheda. Swarabheda is a common feature, but you will have an efforted sputum. The patient would have to strain more, and only after having straining, stressing, a small amount of the sputum will be coming through. Whereas if it is a Pittaja, in that condition, you will have Vurovidaha, that burning sensation in the substernal area is common. This difference is not made out in the contemporary sense. Contemporary sense, trachitis, both these are burning substernal pain as well as dry cough are considered as a common sign. But we are in a position to make out these two categories of the patient separately. Now, management in that condition would be, when the patient has Vataja symptom, my prescription would be Mrityunjaya, Suta Shekara, Lagusuta Mishra and Somasa. When the patient has a Pittaja symptom, instead of Lagusuta Mishrana, I prefer Sitapalari, relatively Chita Virya Dravyas than the Ushna Dravyas as such, and I prefer Pipalyasava. Results would be usually satisfactory, and comparatively, the outcome is better than any of the other contemporary treatment. You will have a good number of patients who have visited other doctors and then coming to you for Ayurvedic treatment in that category. Tracheitis, often the modern contemporary antibiotic treatment doesn't really help. And virtually, there are no such specific treatment for the tracheitis. Even so-called syrups, and then you'll have all that volatile substances, volatile oil containing syrups and so on. They often produce more of irritation than really the resolution. So that's our stronger area. A stronger area for Ayurvedic treatment, tracheitis is our area for treatment. Next. Now, next, as the inflammation goes down further, it's the bronchitis. And bronchitis again, in general, the clinical description of the bronchitis is same, like where you'll have a thick sputum and then a relative low degree of fever as such. But for the clinical identification and maybe from the point of view of clinical management, I categorize them into two categories. It's my categorization, may not be what you see in the text. I would say bronchitis in the usual initial feature would be presented with the Kaphaja Kasa Lakshanas, and that's exactly what Sushruta has said is Abhaktaruk Gauravasadayuttaha. The characteristic feature would be the patient would have a reduced appetite, and the pain would be, symptom will be more when the stomach is empty. Now, a patient of bronchitis, one of the important clinical symptoms, which are not mentioned in the textbooks, some of the patients would say like the cough would be more after consuming the food. Another category of the patient would say cough would be more in empty stomach. Consumption of the food reduces the cough. Now, a consumption of the food reducing the cough and the pain being more or the discomfort being more in the empty stomach is a typical sign of the Kaphaja Kasa, and this is not in the contemporary textbooks. None of the other textbooks would say it's about the Ayurvedic textbook, and it's an important categorization. And in that condition, the drug of choice I prefer would be Tribhuvanakirti. Tribhuvanakirti is a more efficient drug in that Kaphaja involvement. Of course, Mrityunjaya also is given if the patient is febrile. And the same treatment. Steam inhalation is another very significantly beneficial management in case of these bronchitis conditions. And usually, X-ray, when you take the X-ray, you will have only minimal mottling as such. What you see as in the right lower lobe, minimal mottling, of course, Ayurvedic radiology. Now, the minimal mottling seen is a typical sign of Kaphaja Kasa, a one variety of bronchitis.